About 2 months ago, I was challenged to take part in a drag race, and not just any drag race, a £500 cheap car drag race with a few stipulations against four other YouTube channels: Lloyds Vehicle Consulting, Laurie's Mechanical Marvels, Planet Auto, and The Rubbish Mechanic. But to make it interesting, there are a few stipulations to make it, well, an actual challenge. First of all, the car has to be less than £500 and less than 100,000 miles. It has to be petrol, diesel's not allowed, and has to have an MOT. And if it's not got an MOT, your £500 limit includes getting it through a test. Now, so everyone doesn't just go and buy a massively V8ed 7 Series and strip the interior to get the best time down the drag strip, there are a couple of other little things. First of all, there's an economy run on Friday. Oh yeah, the challenge is on Friday, and this is where the car should be. We've got to do a distance drive, and the best economy wins. Then, of course, Saturday Santa Pod, the best time wins. So already, we're against each other a little bit. Thirdly, it's not got to break down. And fourthly, you've got to sell it for a profit. So buying the best car you can is going to limit you on that end. So I've already got some stiff competition. Laurie's Mechanical Marvels have bought the worst 2-litre Toyota Celica in the world, spent hours building it, and now have a drag monster, which, being a Toyota, probably won't break down. Joseph at Lloyds Vehicle Consulting has a Rover 600, again a 2-litre engine, so lots of oomph, lots of top end, but a bit slow being an automatic, and it's a Rover, so it might not make it. But he did get a bonus point for buying a Rover. Then we've got the wild card of a Renault 11. I've had to think slightly outside the box and think of something that's fast, economical, well, fast-ish, and has enough money to polish some profit into it later on in the challenge. I'm just hoping it turns up soon. When I started looking for cars with a £500 limit, my first thought was eBay. There's always something dodgy on eBay. I'm bound to find a bargain there. But the problem with eBay is that very quickly you realize that other people are looking as well. The price you see when you first start looking is often nowhere near it ends up. The place where terrible cars really do end up is Facebook Marketplace. People who don't know about cars look for cars here. People who don't know how to sell cars here. There are some good cars, and there are some people who know what they're talking about as well. But Facebook Marketplace reaches a different kind of market to Auto Trader, motors.co.uk, those kind of people, where people actually know and care about the cars are looking. And if you type in 0 to £500, you find all kinds of stuff. And it's absolutely fascinating. The first thing I nearly bought, and I almost wrung this and paid the money before I realized it was a diesel, a 1998 Escort van. Oh, I might still go back for that. Then I thought, there's 50 bonus points for a Rover. So I started looking at MGFs, and I found some really nice ones. The problem is, though, they're already quite nice. At £300, you're going to have to spend a lot of money to improve it and get any more money at the end of the thing. Then I looked at a couple of Pumas. Pumas are nice, and they're quick, and they're fun, and that you can sell them on for good money if you market them right. But they're all rusty. Every Puma I looked at had horrific rust, and if you find some rust on a Puma, or any Ford from that era, there's going to be a lot more you haven't found. I've been bitten by cheap Fords before from that period. So moving on, I found a really nice, and you guys would have loved this if I'd bought this, £300 for a 70,000 mile 1994 Astra in fairly tidy condition. Not too rusty around the arches, only a few dings around it. But the problem is, it's only a 1.4, so it's not going to be that quick on the drag strip. And I'm going to struggle to sell it for a profit. So, however, then I struck gold. When I first started looking for cars a couple of months ago, but didn't actually get around to buying one, I kept on seeing this car come up. It's advertised for £200. It's been stood for a couple of years, but the owner unfortunately hasn't been very well, and so he's not been able to carry on with it as a project as he'd intended. So it's stood and stood and stood. And it looks horrific in the photos because it's covered in green gunge. And if you look at the MOT history, it says it suffered with rust, but the owner has actually had that professionally sorted out. So it's actually a really solid car, which looks terrible, which is the best way to buy a car if you want to sell it on for a profit at a later date, because the profit's waiting to be polished out of it. I spoke to the guy on the phone, you get a feel for people. He sounded really honest, very trustworthy, very genuine. So I took him at his word and sent him the money. And now I'm sitting here waiting for my car to arrive. Not long now. Not long now, then we'll all know what I've bought. I haven't even seen this in the metal yet. This will be the first time I've actually seen it in the flesh. So here it is, I present to you Hypertension, the Hyundai Coupe. Amazingly well guessed by Admiral Alcatraz on Facebook last night. Well, I don't know how you did that, you must love these cars or know them so well or something, because there's no way I would have guessed that from that picture. It's not the prettiest, but it's got a good engine and it seems pretty solid underneath. Now the thing that really struck me when I saw the photos of this car, I'm gonna have to take the key out because that's very annoying, bing bing, is this interior. This car has only got 39,000 miles on it, or 39,466 I think it says, which is just insane. Look at this leather, it looks like it's never been sat in. The only thing that's currently residing in it is a big spider. That will be going soon. Gear knob looks like it's never been touched, steering wheel is completely unworn. This is astonishing. This interior is absolutely the best thing about this car. The leather seats look like they've pretty much never been sat in. You've got a leathery grip on the door handle, you've got electric windows on both sides, window lock on a two-door car, that's weird. Manual mirrors, that's really curious. Central locking, which works. Five-speed gearbox, recirc, air conditioning. That was an option on these cars, so that's really cool. Hope that still works. And yeah, lots of petrol, but 39,000 miles. I can't believe how good this is. It's even got a pretend leather headlining, and sort of half decent back seats there as well. Once it's running, I will do a proper review of this car, because they're virtually unknown in this country. They're really forgotten. But yeah, I will get this. It's a voyage of discovery. There's some 3D glasses in the door pocket. The only two things in the interior I'm not happy with is the ashtray slash bin doesn't want to open, and there are pop-out cup holders here as well, which also won't open. Glove box is pretty pokey, but it has got the locking wheel nuts in it, which is a relief, because you never know where you're going to get them on a second-hand car. Very swoopy dashboard, no T-shelf action going on whatsoever. So everything is very clearly labelled, so we know this is a power window switch. Only one airbag. Airbag for the driver. Passenger, you're on your own. We die like men. This is on the back of the sun visor on the driver's side. Airbag. See other side. Cross to the passenger side. Airbag. See other side. Back on the driver's side. Airbag. See other side. I haven't looked in the boot yet. Let's go and have a look. What's back there? Now this, before I open the boot, is really the reason this car was so cheap. It's been sat for a very long time. Check that, that's quite a nice boot. Bit of gubbin, bit of grunge. Ooh, full-size spare wheel, brand new Michelin on there. Wow, it's flat, but it looks decent though. I'll replace one of the side wheels with that actually, because these are all a bit old, a bit flat. I might see which is the worst one on the car. They've all got good tread. These are all, actually it's a Mohawk. I think the Mohawk might go in the boot. I'm sure you all want to see is under the bonnet. This is my first time attempting to lift this, so let's find the thing. Wow, there we have double overhead cam, 16 valve, 1.6 litre. I think this makes about 105 horsepower. So the 0 to 60 time I think is around 9 seconds, so it's probably no match for the Celica, but it will give the Rover a run for its money. But look at this. This is all just so, okay, it's dirty, but under the dirt, it's actually really, really solid and clean. This will scrub up so nicely. I think the battery might be a bit low or possibly not charging because the light was on a tiny bit. Now this afternoon, I'm gonna give this an oil change. Maybe pop the plugs out and give them a quick clean up, and put the battery on charge and clean all its contacts. And then, oh, this isn't really an MOT fail. This isn't perforated. This is the worst thing on the car, this bubbling arch. But for what I'm gonna do, I can just I can sand it, rust kill it, skim it with a bit of filler, and rattle can it with the right colour, and it will be more than presentable. And tomorrow, go for an MOT and see where that leaves us. This was running a minute ago. I'm trying to shield this microphone from the wind. This was running a few minutes ago, and it actually drove down the drive and parked, but it did stall and wouldn't restart because the battery was flat. So I'm quick jump it, and you'll hear the engine. Bing, bing, bing. This is incredibly smooth. Ah, but the petrol in it is ancient, so I need to run this petrol out on it, or drain the petrol out, so it's got fresh fuel that's not going to keep cutting out on me. Bother, okay. Battery needs to go on charge, or I may need to steal the Tomcat's battery during the challenge. Oh, hang on. That might be the reason. It wasn't charging. This is actually not even pushed tight. Let me go find a small spanner. Yeah, the charge light was on a minute ago. I just picked up every one of the wrong size. There we go, that's it. It's an 11 mil. Oh, that's better. I think it was actually a 10. So it's not making a great connection, it's sparking a wee bit and cutting out. That's not, oh, I won't tighten up at all. That's interesting. That's finger tight as well. First of our issues. Suddenly it seems like buying a car 4 days before the event. Oh, there's no battery restraint either. The battery's only just held in by gravity, so I'm gonna have to source some kind of battery restraint. This feels like it won't actually tighten up enough to stay tight on the battery. There we go, that's taken a bit of an oomph, but it's there, and the earth is quite loose as well, so I'll tighten that up here while I'm here. Right, whoops, can't get off the screw now. There we go. Right, let's see if it starts now. No, still not brilliant. Right, so that does start fine. I'm gonna move into a more sensible position on the drive now in case it stalls again. Okay, there is one more issue I hadn't found. It won't rev beyond 3000 RPM. That will be an issue for a drag race. Yeah, these alloy wheels are incredible. They're not scuffed at all. There's a little bit of bubbling on the paint, sadly, but you know, it's barely noticeable from a distance. Either it's using no fuel at all, because it's been running for ages, or the fuel gauge is broken, and the temperature gauge is holding really steady as well. It does not want to rev though. That's not good. So I might need to, well, I do need to get this to a garage to get plugged into a diagnostic machine as soon as possible. Okay, that sounds worse now. I wonder if it might be the crank position sensor, because I'm revving it and the needle is going the wrong way on the gauge. This is going to scrub up as a really nice car, I think. Well, so there we have it, my 2001 Hyundai Coupe 1.6 SE Challenge car. On the plus side, it seems like a pretty solid car. The interior is like new, it's never been sat in. It's got a new Sony radio with USB input on it, although I can't figure out how to turn it on. It's got an electric aerial, which only wants to come on with the radio, which won't come on. And yeah, I think it's quite a nice looking car. The bad points, which I need to look at right now. First of all, it needs an oil change instantly. It needs fresh petrol in it. It's got half a tank in there, so I need to run that down a bit more. It won't rev over 3,000 RPM. That might be a sensor, it might be the dirty fuel, it might be the fact the battery's a bit low. I don't know, I need to investigate that quickly. It's not got a battery tie-down strap, so I need to cable tie that in, because I'm not spending money on one. And it needs a really, really good clean. I was gonna leave it dirty and just have it, call it hypertension, because it's disgusting, and it's red, and it's gonna cause me grief. That's its name. And I need to sort out that little bit of rust. There's a few jobs, and then an MOT, hopefully tomorrow. Not that I'm in a hurry or anything. Join me next time when you see this car looking shiny.